All right, hello anatomy friends. Let us talk about some arteries. A lot of our videos have focused a lot on the joints and the muscles, so it is important to talk about what's actually supplying blood to these structures. So we will focus first on the axillary artery and how we divide up the axillary artery, what are the main branches, and then we'll finish talking about the important posterior scapular anastomoses that are going to be some of the branches from axillary artery and the subclavian. Okay, so as you hopefully recall from some of the active learning sessions, there is going to be one main artery that really supplies the upper limb, and it basically just changes its name in certain areas. So we're looking here at the root of the neck. We know this because here's your thyroid gland. You can see the common carotid coming off the thyrocervical trunk here. And then this right here is the subclavian artery. So we remember dissecting this when we were dissecting the root of the neck. You can see a little bit of the lung here. This is your anterior scalene muscle. If you recall that, remember that is the muscle that kind of subdivides the subclavian artery. And the axillary artery is going to begin right about here-ish. And the reason I know this is because I can see your first rib here. So this is the first rib. It's been cut. I also know this is the first rib because the anterior scalene attaches on the first rib. So just distal to the first rib is where the name change occurs, and now we are calling this vessel or this artery the axillary artery. And so we're out of the root of the neck and we're moving more into the axillary region, as its name would suggest. Now, before we move on, there are going to be two arteries that are going to come off of the subclavian that are going to play a role in terms of the posterior scapular anastomoses that we'll see later. But I just want to have a nice review. We've looked at these previously, well back in the second block. But let's review real quickly while we're here. All right. So this is the subclavian artery. This is the first part of the subclavian artery, and this is your thyrocervical trunk. Off of the thyrocervical trunk, which is right here, so first part of the subclavian, you're going to have an artery called the suprascapular. So you have a lot coming off the thyrocervical trunk. You'll also have the transverse cervical here, which is usually superior to the suprascapular. But I do want to point that one of those branches of the thyrocervical trunk is the suprascapular artery. And it is heading back towards the posterior part of the scapula. And you can kind of see it heading in that direction. So that's going to be one of the branches that's going to anastomose on the back of the scapula. The other one is right here. And this is your dorsal scapular. It is typically in the third part of the subclavian. And that makes sense if this is the anterior scalene, lateral to the anterior scalene. There's only one branch, which is the dorsal scapular. And you can see that pretty clearly here. The thyrocervical trunk is on the first part, or medial to the anterior scalene. And so suprascapular and dorsal scapular we'll see again when we're looking at the posterior scapula. But wanted to show you here where it's actually coming off of the subclavian artery. Okay, so let's move down into the axillary artery and axillary vein. Now in this particular image, you do not see the axillary vein. You can see kind of where it has been cut in this region, but it would be anterior to the axillary artery. But we wanted to focus on the artery and the artery branches, because typically they're a little bit easier to see, and the veins just kind of follow along with the arteries as well. So, similar to what we had with the subclavian artery, this artery will be subdivided into parts as well. And this is going to be subdivided by the pectoralis major. So the pectoralis major, remember, is going to kind of be located in about this-ish region. So the muscle belly would be right here. You can see a little bit of the tendon right here, and it will subdivide from there. Maybe went a little too kind of distal right here, but this is where the belly would be. So this would make this the first part of the axillary artery. This would be the second part. And so the second part would be deep to the muscle belly of pectoralis major, or excuse me, minor. And then the third part is going to be lateral to the pectoralis minor. So first part is going to be medial, second part is deep, third part is lateral or distal, similar to what we had with the subclavian with the anterior scalene. Now, if we're talking branches, the cool thing about the number of branches that's going to correspond with the part number. So the first part will only have one branch, and this is going to be the superior thoracic. We're not having you identify this one, but we do want you to conceptually understand that this is coming off of the first part. You can see it kind of heading towards the intercostal regions. The second part has two branches, but we're only having you identify one, which is the thoracoacromial. And you can see that right about here-ish. And that it's a fairly short trunk before it starts to send off numerous branches to different areas. Some of the more important areas are pectoralis major and minor, as well as the deltoid. There'll be branches to that as well. So it's a fairly short trunk and then almost immediate branches. The second branch of the second part of the axillary is the lateral thoracic, and you can actually see that here. We're not having you ID that, but I am going to point it out since you can see it on this image, and that's heading to supply the serratus anterior. Okay, so first part has one branch, second part has two branches, third part, so distal to or lateral to the pectoralis minor, is going to have three branches. So the first and typically the largest, and this one's a little on the smaller side, but this is your subscapular. And the subscapular is another example of a fairly short trunk before it splits into its two terminal branches. And those are thoracodorsal, which you can see here. And the reason I know this is thoracodorsal is because it looks like it's going to supply your latissimus dorsi. All right? So it's the one that's going to continue inferiorly to head towards the muscle belly region of the latissimus dorsi. How I can differentiate it from the other terminal branch of subscapular, which is the circumflex scapular, is that thoracodorsal should be heading inferiorly. Circumflex scapular is going to kind of move backwards to head towards the scapula. So one's heading down, one's heading laterally to get to the scapula. So that's how you're going to tell the difference between those two terminal branches. The other two branches of the third part of the axillary are the anterior circumflex, and you can see this heading anteriorly, and the posterior circumflex, which is typically considerably larger in terms of diameter than the anterior circumflex. And you can see that is the case on this particular donor here. So anterior circumflex, posterior circumflex, these are heading to kind of loop around the surgical neck region, and that's an important point here, the surgical neck of the humerus. Remember that one? That is not the anatomical neck, which is right next to the head. This is that kind of thin portion of the shaft just distal to the greater and the lesser tubercles. So the anterior circumflex and the posterior circumflex will circumflex or circumvent or go around basically the surgical neck region. Now looking back at this again, hopefully this is a familiar image to you. You can see the posterior circumflex here as well as the axillary nerve. So remember the axillary nerve is one of the terminal branches of the brachial plexus. It's going to go supply the deltoid, which you can see is reflected here. And these two kind of travel together on the posterior side of the surgical neck. of the humerus. So that relationship between those two, if you have a fracture to the surgical neck of the humerus, not only can you, not only could that affect the posterior circumflex humeral, but it could also affect the axillary nerve, which is going to be what's supplying or innervating the deltoid muscle, as well as teres minor. So this is heading in this posterior region here, so you could also see posterior circumflex here. Okay, so to that promised anastomoses that I talked about on the posterior scapula. Now we know we're looking at a posterior view, and I might sound like a broken record because I've said this in quite a few videos that I've recorded, but I know I'm looking at a posterior view because here is that scapular spine. And if you continue laterally, then it will transition into the acromion. There are going to be three main branches that are going to play a role in terms of the scapular anastomoses. And specifically, these three branches will send smaller branches that will actually anastomose with one another. So let's figure out which one is which. For me, when I am trying to identify or differentiate between these, I always try to find the dorsal scapular first. I feel like it's one of the easier ones to locate, and it is always very much kind of following along the border, the medial border of the scapula. And so you remember that medial border is going to be right along here, because acromion's always lateral, so this is the medial border, and this fairly large artery, the dorsal scapular, is going to just follow along this medial border here. So this is dorsal scapular here. Now, review. We just discussed this, but these are the kind of things that I hope that you're remembering. What is the dorsal scapular artery a branch of? It is a branch of the third part of the subclavian. All right, so this is coming all the way from the subclavian. Additionally, the suprascapular is also coming from the subclavian, or that first part of the subclavian, and it is going to be located on the superior portions of the scapula and sending branches to this posterior portion here. So subclavian, this is subclavian branch, this is subclavian branch, and then you're going to have an axillary artery branch, which is your circumflex scapular, as we just saw on that anterior view coming off of the subscapular artery, excuse me. So what this is going to do is going to kind of wrap around this more lateral border of the scapula. So you can see kind of the larger diameter, the bulk of the artery, and then it's sending these small branches to the posterior portion. So you have an area here where you can have anastomoses between branches of both the subclavian and the axillary. So if you have, say, some type of occlusion that occurs right around the beginning of the axillary artery, even in the second part of the axillary artery, the posterior scapula can still have blood supply because you are having some subclavian artery branches associated with it. So this is one of my favorite pictures. This is a particularly difficult dissection, but you can really clearly see the basic locations of these three main branches of the posterior scapular anastomoses. So to review, dorsal scapular along the medial border. Suprascapular is going to be associated with the superior portion of the scapula. It's going to go through what's called the suprascapular notch, kind of above it, and then send off branches here. And then your circumflex scapular, which is a branch of the axillary, is going to kind of loop around this lateral border of the scapula to send branches to anastomose. All right, so that is a kind of a review of the arteries and the axillary region, as well as the posterior scapular anastomoses. Hopefully this is a nice review from the overview session and the shoulder and brachial plexus session. As always, we love talking arteries when us anatomists, and so please feel free to reach out, and hopefully we can help with some tricks of the trade in terms of identifying some of these branches. But as always, understanding what these branches are going to supply will help you understand why a certain artery needs to be heading in certain directions. All right, have a good rest of your day.